What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you have a fantastic Thursday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show. And before we jump into it, just a quick note. This morning I posted the third of the three morning news videos that we are testing this week. If you haven't seen, we've been testing this since we've been getting hit by YouTube constantly over the stories we're covering. Which, by the way, we'll talk about the results of the testing this week. It's been very interesting. The main point this morning, we talked about the heartbreaking and very important stories around Molly Tibbetts and Chris Watts. And the reason I'm mentioning this at the beginning of the video is so that one, after today's show, you can go watch that one, as well as two, kind of try and head off any comments or question as far as why didn't you talk about this story, even though we did in another video. But with that said, for today's show, let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today is somewhat of an update to a story that we covered a few weeks ago. There's a lot of outrage around a series that was going to be coming out on Netflix called Insatiable. Essentially, the story is this girl that was very large and picked on. She gets punched in the jaw. She doesn't eat for several months. All of a sudden, she becomes very attractive and thin. She then uses her newfound body and position in the world as a way to get revenge on others. A lot of people thought that this was fat shaming, disgusting, it was just a bad move. And I was personally of the mindset of, well, let's see what the series actually looks like. Right, maybe there's a lesson along the way. I don't think there is anything inherently evil with a story arc that involves someone drastically changing weight and thus being treated different by others. I have a previous high school, college experience with that. I wanted to be open to it. And since the series came out on Netflix, a lot of people have asked me, well, what do you think about the series? And my response is, I don't know if it's problematic, like the intent seems to be that it is a dark comedy, but it's just kind of bad. I just found myself watching the show and going, this is just stupid. Maybe it pans out after the third episode, but it just felt like an effort at that point, and that's not what you want out of a show. But also, me kind of giving a review there is related to what we're seeing today, because right now, this show has an audience rating of 4.2 out of 5 on Rotten Tomatoes. And in fact, on Rotten Tomatoes, it's been reviewed over 1,700 times, and 84% of the users that reviewed it gave it a positive score. But it turns out, something may be up here. And the people over at IntoMore.com decided to dive deep on the reviews to see if maybe these were fake accounts, they were bots. And so they looked into 105 star ratings, right? The people that loved this. And they looked for things that would help identify if this was a fake account, it was a bot account, or it was actually a legitimate account. Things like, does this account have any reviews? Is there a profile? Do they have a profile with dead links? And what they said they found was that more than a third or 36% of users who liked Insatiable had never previously reviewed a single film or TV show on Rotten Tomatoes. And 6% of the audience members had only sounded off once before, and most of those reviews were tallied in the past 24 hours. And ultimately, they said, a near unanimous 96% of all user reviews were suspect at best. And so essentially, long story short, a lot of the data seems to point to there being a good number of troll reviews, as well as people just going there to rate it high as kind of a protest review, right? Kind of as a middle finger to the people that were offended by this before it was even released. And the number of reviews on this series compared to that of shows that have been referred to as breakout hits has seemingly been disproportionate on several websites, with Insatiable receiving a ton more. But also among those reviews, I'm sure there are people that genuinely like the series. Entertainment is subjective. This is also not that unique of a story. I mean, whenever a business pops up in the news, it usually gets flooded with 1- and 5-star reviews. Whenever there's an entertainer that is outspoken one way or another and something popped up on Netflix, people were going 1 to 5 stars. So there's that. But I guess for me, main point, no, I was not offended by anything. I just thought it was stupid. In fact, actually, I have to read my favorite review. It's even in the article on Into More. Lorraine Ali of the Los Angeles Times said, Insatiable makes Norbit feel like a comedic masterpiece. So there was that. Sorry, Debbie Ryan, I don't want to add to the pylon. It just wasn't for me. Then in super fun internet security news, we look to Australia. And this is because there was a security audit of the Western Australian government. And this audit found that 26% of their officials use weak or common passwords. And when looking at 234,000 individuals in 17 government agencies, they found that more than 5,000 people use the word password in their password. And 1,464 of these individuals tried to throw hackers off of their scent by using password 123. And so I guess just take this story as a reminder to not have stupid passwords. Here's the thing, I'm personally of the belief that no matter how much you try to protect yourself, there will always be someone smarter or ahead of the curve, and people are going to be able to get access to your stuff. But don't make it this easy for them. And of course, it's even more concerning that government officials are not immune to these same mistakes. So there you go. And if I seem frustrated, it's because I know that people aren't going to learn. We've covered varying versions of this story for the past 5 years. But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today and today in Awesome, brought to you by SeatGeek. And SeatGeek is, of course, a fantastic ticket app that takes confusion out of buying tickets for live events, whether it be a concert, a comedy show, a sporting event, or whatever. They put all the tickets in one place, they give them 0 to 100 scores so you know if you're getting a good deal or not. I've got the app on my phone, and it is by far the easiest way to get tickets, whether it be something last minute or something down the road that I'm looking forward to. And if you haven't used them before, it's a great time to do it. I mean, you have baseball season, NFL seasons right around the corner. There's tons of concerts, whether it be Taylor Swift, Drake, Childish Gambino, whoever. And best of all, if you go to SeatGeekPhil.com, you download the SeatGeek app, make sure you enter an offer code Phil, because when you do, they will give you $20 off your first ticket purchase. And the first bit of awesome, and this might be too nerdy for some of you, starting August 27th at 1 p.m. Eastern over on Twitch, they're going to start streaming Pokemon the anime series as well as every movie. They're even doing this co-watching overlay series where you can catch Pokemon, and I'm just 100% on board with this. Then we had those OG YouTubers by the name of Rhett and Link on Hot Ones. Then, interestingly enough, we had Rhett and Link on their show Good Mythical Morning having Liza Koshy on. We had Rami Malek and Charlie Hunnam answering the web's most searched questions. We got a trailer for Suspiria. HBO gave us a Best of Hard Knocks, which, by the way, even if you do not care about football, really enjoyable show. And the last bit of awesome, and it kind of ends up being a little bit of a story of its own, I just have to give a shout out to, I feel like, the breakout star from the past 1 to 2 months, and that is True Geordie. No matter who loses in the KSI Logan Paul fight, the ultimate winner of this event has been True Geordie. Since the first press conference, this guy has gained around 500,000 new subscribers, and I think well deserved, because in addition to his content around this situation, I think a lot of people, including myself, have learned that he is a fantastic podcaster and just a cool guy. And he, along with Matt Wilson of Wall Street Network and game developer Viker, put out a game called BoxTuber around the idea of YouTubers fighting one another. And in just the first 24 hours it was released this past Sunday, it got 100,000 downloads. And I just have to give props on the hustle and just seeing someone really maximize their opportunity. And if you want to see the full versions of everything, I'll just share the secret link of the day, anything at all. Links, as always, are in the description down below. And then let's talk about this situation in South Africa that we've actually covered before on this show, but has now become an international issue and incident thanks to Donald Trump tweeting about it. So last night, among many other Donald Trump stories, many other Donald Trump and White House tweets, we saw the president himself tweet, "I've asked Secretary of State Mike Pompeo to closely study the South Africa land and farm seizures and expropriations and the large-scale killing of farmers. Quote, South African government is now seizing land from white farmers," end quote, at Tucker Carlson at Fox News. And that tweet appeared to be in response to Tucker Carlson on Fox News talking about this story. But this is also not an out-of-nowhere news story. I mean, the story of forcibly grabbing land and the killing of white farmers has been a highly controversial subject in South Africa. Like I said, we covered the situation back in February. This included major constitutional changes. I'll link to the video down below. But to talk about what's happening now, I feel like it's important that we do a TLDR, get everyone up to speed. South Africa had a racist system of government called apartheid. And during apartheid, much of the land was set aside to be used by whites only. So by the end of apartheid, 90% of the land was owned by white South Africans, who made up only about 10% of the population. And after apartheid, land redistribution was a major platform for many South African political parties, and the constitution reflected that. And it gave the responsibility to the government to actively try and redistribute land by buying it from farmers with, quote, just and equitable compensation. And it even allowed the government to force farmers to sell their land with a court order. But that process was slow, and by 2016, almost no progress was made. 72% of the land was still owned by whites, 15% by people of color who were mixed, and just 4% by black people. Which brings us back to what we last covered here, which was that motions were introduced to begin the process to change the constitution to allow for land to forcibly be taken without compensation. And then we fast forward to now, where the reason this is back in the news is there are now reports that the South African government has moved to take property without compensation, even though the constitution has not officially been changed yet. We're seeing headlines like South Africa begins seizing white-owned farms. We're seeing segments like the one we talked about with Tucker Carlson.
The president of South Africa, Cyril Ramaphosa, has begun, and you may have seen this in the press, seizing land from his own citizens without compensation because they are the wrong skin color. That is literally the definition of racism.
And this has really come back in the news because there are certain farms that are the focus of land seizure this week. So there are these two farms in Limpopo owned by Ackerland Botery who are in talks with the government to sell them the property as the constitution demands. But the negotiations had stalled for years. The government offered 20 million rand while the farmers wanted 200 million rand. But then over the weekend, a local source called News 24 reported that the owners of the property received a notice earlier in the year that the government decided they wanted too much for the farm and the government would just be taking the land without a court order. Once again, keep in mind, this is before the constitution has officially been changed. Right now, the parties are still reviewing proposals on wordings on how forcibly taking property without compensation would work under a new amendment. But that said, a majority still do agree and voted for a motion to formally change the constitution to allow this. And so this situation in Limpopo has been seen as a test case to see if land can be taken without compensation under the current constitution, which may actually allow such a thing to happen, quote, in the public interest. And various legal experts in South Africa say that in certain cases, it should be possible to take the land without any money offered, as that would be, quote, just and equitable. This depending on how the land was originally acquired acquired from the locals. But at this point, that has never been confirmed in court there. And that's of no, because with these two farms, they're saying that they belong to a local tribe, despite a court not formally reviewing the evidence and the disputes by the current owner. It's generally understood that under the current constitution and laws, notably Section 42E of the Restitution of Land Rights Act, if the land were to be forcibly taken by the Land Reform Office and compensation was given, it would need a court order to do so. And it's believed that Ackerland is just the first farm on an alleged list of 139 farms that the ruling ANC party have. But President Ramaphosa denies this, saying these groups are going around spreading lies and rumors. They're running overseas and saying the ANC is out for land grabs. There is no such thing. The ANC wants to ensure that there is the land reform that is going to lead to the growth of our economy and agricultural growth, and if we embrace this approach, we are going to restore the dignity of our people. And then there's the issue and topic here regarding attacks and deaths of white South Africans. And some have even gone on to say that this is the beginnings of a white genocide in South Africa, although that is also heavily disputed. And the thing is, when we look to South Africa, without a doubt, there have been deaths of white farmers in the country. And it's believed by many that some of them have likely been race-based killings because of the way the bodies were mangled. But you also have people arguing that these are not race-based killings, saying many are thought to be robberies gone bad. This because there is a widespread perception that these farmers are quite rich. And interestingly enough, these attacks against farmers are not a new thing. In fact, according to the attack numbers on record, the numbers that we're seeing in 2017, 2018, that there were 561 official attacks of this kind during that time period, it's actually half of what we saw in 2001 to 2002. And those years were the height of attacks against farmers, and we saw 1,069. And both of these numbers include rapes, robberies, as well as killings. But it's also important to note that there are groups in South Africa that dispute those numbers. Afriforum, which is a group that represents white South Africans, they say 156 commercial farmers per 100,000 of the population is killed, saying they are five times more likely than the average person to be murdered. And then outside of these two sides, you have another group called Africa Check that has said that there are no reliable estimates of how many people were working on farms. And so because of that, they say accurately calculating the death rate is impossible. And as far as the South African government's response to everything we've seen over the past 24 hours, we saw them tweet and even adding Donald Trump. South Africa totally rejects this narrow perception which only seeks to divide our nation and reminds us of our colonial past. Hashtag land expropriation. And so that's where we are with this situation today. But where I do want to end this story is around the question of redistribution. Even without the constitutional change, the reports of the intent but not takeover yet of this farm. What are your thoughts around the South African president calling for the expropriation without compensation? This idea of taking land from someone without pay because of things that happened in the past to make that quote right. Do you agree with Ramaphosa's thinking there? Or do you think, no, this is just another wrong? You know, that argument that two wrongs don't make a right. I'd love to see your thoughts in those comments down below. Then in the president of the United States fighting with his own attorney general in public, we look to this morning's Fox and Friends interview with Donald Trump.
I put an attorney general that never took control of the Justice Department, Jeff Sessions. I wanted to stay uninvolved. But when everybody sees what's going on in the Justice Department, I always put justice now with quotes, it's a very, very sad day. Jeff Sessions recused himself, which he shouldn't have done.
And today, Attorney General Jeff Sessions released a statement saying, I took control of the Department of Justice the day I was sworn in, which is why we have had unprecedented success at effectuating the president's agenda. While I am Attorney General, the actions of the Department of Justice will not be improperly influenced by political considerations. I demand the highest standards, and where they are not met, I take action. However, no nation has a more talented, more dedicated group of law enforcement investigators and prosecutors than the United States. And part of his statement, other than the general pushback that he provided here that may have stuck out to you, is the while I am Attorney General part. It kind of feels like he is preparing to be replaced, and it's not just Trump's words that may have started this. It kind of feels like he is bracing to be kicked out. And today we saw two key Republican senators seemingly say that they were on board. You had Chuck Grassley of Iowa, who had previously said he was too busy to do so, saying he'd be able to schedule hearings to confirm a new Attorney General. You had Lindsey Graham of South Carolina telling reporters,
the president's entitled to Attorney General he has faith in, somebody that's qualified for the job. And I think there will come a time, sooner rather than later, where it will be time to have a new face and a fresh voice at the Department of Justice. Clearly, Attorney General Sessions doesn't have the confidence of the president.
But Graham also mentioned that this should happen after the midterms, and to do so beforehand would create havoc. But obviously this is massive news, because if Donald Trump were to kick Sessions to the curb, it could be the first of several steps to stop the Mueller investigation. While Jeff Sessions has been incredibly loyal to the president, Donald Trump has had a massive issue with his recusal. And so if he was out, Donald Trump gets a nominee, that person gets confirmed, they're not recused, boom. But ultimately we're gonna have to wait to see what happens, and obviously we'll keep our eyes peeled. field. And that's where we're going to end today's show. And as always, remember, this is also meant to be a conversation, so whether it be the last story, the first one, anything in between, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. Also, while you're at it, if you like this video, throw us a like. If you're new here, make sure to hit subscribe so you don't miss these daily Philip DeFranco shows and maybe even some more of those new morning videos we've been testing. It also never hurts to ring that bell to turn on notifications. But that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.